From Nazareth to Bethlehem, a young couple is forced to travel. The government has sent out an order demanding that everyone show up and be counted. In those days, you couldn't just mail in your registration form. You had to appear in person, regardless of your circumstances. She is heavy with child, ready to give birth at any moment. Her husband is filled with the urgency of the situation, yet he leads her slowly, gently, taking great care to assist her as they enter the city gates. They are poor, young, and nearly invisible in the midst of the more affluent. Peasants from the country, good only for heavy labor and even heavier taxation. Dirty, tired, hungry, desperately seeking a place to rest for the night, yet no one will even give them so much as the time of day. The local inns are booked solid. And besides, who wants the burden of a young girl ready to give birth? There's a lot of money to be made in this town tonight. We have no time for compassion. This year, as we celebrated and remembered that young couple and their struggle to find a room, the city of St. Louis was busy seizing and destroying the blankets and belongings of everyone found living on the streets. In the snow and ice and freezing temperatures, human beings were kicked about and told to move on. Move on to where? No one was going to be letting them indoors. There wasn't any room in the inn for these people. Were there any pregnant teens in their midst? Who knew? Who cared? There was a lot of money to be made in the city of St. Louis that night. There was no time for compassion. But the young couple in our story does find a place to stay. A barn, out of the way, out of sight, but what a relief! Shelter for the night, a place to lay down, a place to tend to the dire need of giving birth. The contractions are coming faster now. Squat, push, again and again and again. So much pain, so many fluids, birth, new life, blood, dirty straw, curious cows screaming, and oh, the pain. Until at last, silence. The whole world holding its breath. Suspended animation, a moment that seems to stretch into eternity until suddenly it is shattered by a loud, strong cry into the night. I'm awake, I'm alive, fear not. God is with us, Emmanuel. The young husband carefully makes a nest of hay in a feeding trough. The hay is not fresh. Actually, it's filthy. But he reverently places his one and only cloak on top of the straw and then gently places the infant on top of his cloak. There's water in another trough. Just enough to clean the mother and the child. The animals don't mind. They know. They know the significance and the honor of what has just occurred. This was no ordinary birth. And that baby, that was no ordinary baby either. Young sir, have our water be cleansed by what little bit we have to offer. For unto us this day a child is born. And everything has changed. God with us. Who knew? Who knew that in a dirty barn, God had emerged, tiny, helpless, vulnerable, and fully dependent on the care of humans? Two parents, three shepherds, and a handful of cows knew. But even if they couldn't fully understand what that meant, even then, even today, having had 2,000 years we still don't fully understand what went down that night. It's so far-fetched. God with us, starting from scratch, emerging from the bottom of the human pile. Why then? Why there? What does that really mean? We ponder this mystery every year. For thousands of years, we have told and retold our Christmas story. We act it out. We sing about it. We talk about it. We study it. Year after year, generation after generation, we encounter and consider the meaning and the significance of the Christmas event. Yet we still struggle to grasp what it meant for an almighty and all-powerful God to enter this world as a newborn baby, born in a stable, surrounded by animals. It's hard for us to even imagine that scene in its raw form. In the nitty-gritty details of foul odors, fear, sweat, blood, and tears. Try to imagine. Just try to imagine God being born on the streets of Calcutta or in the margins of the Congo, a savior to the lost and forgotten. Can we imagine encountering God in those places? Can we imagine encountering God in the sewers, the tent cities, in the crack houses, in the shadowy world of the unseen? We can't imagine that, can we? It's impossible for us to imagine because we've never been to those places. We've never lived in those places. We've never been trapped in those places. But those were the places where God showed up first. Through the portal of a poor teenage girl, those were the places God entered this broken and unjust world to touch and to heal and to offer a better way. In the eyes of the world, that girl was a nobody from nowhere. She had no purpose beyond exploitation. But God saw her. God saw her humanity, her hopes, her dreams, and God heard her prayers. Word spread quickly. People showed up. Hope rose in weary hearts, and everyone wanted to see, touch, and celebrate this miracle that no one could grasp, but all could sense. God with us. Here. Can you believe it? That part's not too hard to imagine, the part about everybody showing up. Even today, when word gets out of the supernatural, people flock to the site. Fatima, Lourdes, Assisi, we all want to experience and taste divinity. We all want reassurance that there's something more, something bigger, something better. But when word starts to spread, eventually, it makes its way into the wrong ears. And in this case, the wrong ears belong to a man named Herod. We all know Herod. We all dread Herod. Yet every generation is forced to endure its own brand of Herod. Herod represents that core nucleus of power. He is a figurehead for all of the tyrants in the world who call the shots behind closed doors, ordering that city streets be swept of the homeless, that dogs and fire hoses be unleashed on peaceful protesters, that bombs be dropped, that cities be destroyed, that innocent children be slaughtered. Herod doesn't get his own hands dirty. He sends others to do his dirty work for him. He sends soldiers to destroy the baby Jesus. He sends police officers to rid the streets of the homeless. He sends the repo man to possess cars and mortgage lenders to seize homes. He sends people like us to do his dirty work against people like us. Herod's mission is to crush any hope brewing in people, because he knows that if people have hope, then Herod loses control. I can't help but wonder how the soldiers felt as they carried out Herod's terrible command. I can't help but wonder how the police officers of St. Louis felt returning to their warm homes and holiday decorations after a long night of sweeping the streets of the homeless. I wonder if any of them sat up late into the night, remembering the pain and the suffering, the haunted eyes, the smells, the crying and lamenting. How could they have executed that command and participated so directly in such horror? We don't know. We can't explain it. So we justify it by saying that they were just following orders and doing their jobs. We justify it by saying that the victims were breaking the law. Laws against homelessness. Laws against peaceful protesting. Laws against being Black, Muslim, or Hispanic, but especially that really big law against being a tiny baby who poses a threat to a king. We justify it because that's how you keep your own place in this world. The world of Herod demands compliance, and if you don't want to find yourself on the bottom, you comply. No one wants to be on the bottom. It's one of our greatest fears. No one wants to be destitute with nowhere to go. No one wants to be among the lost, the forgotten, the unseen. The world of Herod demands obedience. It demands that we follow the rules, do our jobs, pay our tributes, and swear allegiance or end up with nothing. The world of Herod feeds on fear, insecurity, and the notion of scarcity. It thrives on mistrust, suspicion, hatred, and division. Of course, Jesus came in from the bottom. It was the only way to expose the fraud at the top, and to show us another way, a better path, a barely noticeable, overgrown path that begins in that place of invisibility where there's nothing left to lose. He came to show us the way to freedom, redemption, restoration, wholeness, and healing, but we will never step foot on that path as long as we are clinging to the false sense of security offered to us by Herod. We have to let go of our attachment to our stuff, to our desires for more stuff, to our fear of losing the stuff that we already have. We have to let go of our need for certainty, our illusions for safety, and our misconceptions about control, identity, and status. These are the false illusions dangled before us by Herod so that we will comply and do his dirty work for him. There was this rich man who wanted to follow Jesus, and Jesus told him everything that he needed to do. And the guy was okay with all that until Jesus told him that you have to go out and you have to get rid of all of your money and your possessions and give them away to the poor. At that point, the guy had to turn around and go home. Now, please understand that I'm not suggesting that we need to go out this afternoon and unload all of our money and our belongings. What I am saying is that it is our attachment to these things that keep us enslaved to Herod. We have to let go of our fear of what we'll lose if we refuse to comply with orders that we know are wrong. That's the path to freedom from Herod's evil agenda. And that's the narrow path that is so difficult for us to commit to. Chris Christopherson once penned the words, "Freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose." And it's exactly like that. When we let go, when we stop clinging and craving and seeking more, we find ourselves in a place where Herod can no longer control us with our own fear. We become free, and it is there that we encounter God. God hangs out in that empty space of invisibility, that place where there's nothing left to lose and everything to gain. Jesus turned our expectations inside out. He said, "Blessed are the poor, the meek, and the ones who mourn." He said that a camel had a better shot at making it through the eye of a needle than a rich person does of making it into the kingdom of heaven. Those who are already at the bottom are already 1 foot into the kingdom. Of course, that's where he would show up. Christmas is not about comforting those who are already comfortable. It's about a God who cared enough to show up in the flesh and expose the fallacy to all of us of Herod. It's about a God who showed up to help us understand that there is no power in the world that is strong enough to keep us apart from God or from each other if we just let go of the illusion and the lies of Herod. In reality, in the kingdom of heaven, there is no top or bottom. There is no seen or unseen. There is no in or out. There's just us, living together in peace and harmony and loving our Creator with everything that we have. The birth of Jesus was a human mess filled with holy redemption. It was the beginning of something huge that changed the world forever. And it left behind a tiny door that offered a glimpse into the realm of love and freedom. Through this strange birth, we have come to see that true freedom can only be accessed by way of a very narrow path where vulnerability is the gateway. God meets us in our discomfort, in our aching need, and provides a light to guide us. God among us, God with us, Emmanuel. Amen.
Amen.
And now it is time for our